allowed to swear given the audience?
Yeah. She'll say, oi.
Welcome to episode 35 of the Just movie Lighthouse, shining a light through the fog of film. My name is James.
I'm Laurie.
And I'm Wyndham.
Hey, guys. Been a while.
It's been a while, chaps, isn't it?
Yeah.
Crikey. I'm just conscious, you know, like this sort of disconnect. We're in that sort of our own little worlds, as it were. We just allow other priorities to get in the way where you should just keep things going.
Me and Wyndham were at a barbecue together last weekend.
Oh, well.
Yeah. Which was lovely. All suitably socially distanced. Most of the time.
I still wear marigolds to Sainsbury's.
You would,
yeah.
Really? Is that right?
I just like the way, because like if I'm ever queuing or anything, if you just give it a little pinch of your hands.
Get that squelchy noise, yeah.
Jesus. You've got it bad enough.
I've actually been out and about quite a lot.
Right, I might have to apologise in advance. However, it's probably my standard quality range, but last night I discovered margaritas, how to make margaritas. So I recently watched Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Yeah, I love that film.
And they drink margaritas.
What's in a margarita? Is it tequila?
They are good.
Yeah, so you got your tequila base, which obviously is always a good start. And then you've got some triple sec in there, loads of lime, loads of ice, and then a ton of mystery. It's great.
I was going to say, is that it? Tequila and triple sec? There's got to be something
just
else. Again,
ice and lime juice. Yeah.
Is that it? Wow, no wonder it's a bit punchy.
Yeah, she was punchy.
Brilliant. Mm.
Louise went out for dinner with some friends a couple of weeks ago. And while it's very good that places are open and trying to survive again, she was charged £16 for a margarita.
Saintly heavens.
What? Which seems a bit punchy given there's not a great deal in it.
Yeah. Well, you can get like some proper snazzy tequilas out there. And maybe she was
16 quid.
Maybe that was it.
You could just buy a bottle of tequila. Crikey.
Yeah.
Right. Well, should we get on to the question in hand or point in hand, whatever the phrase is?
The agenda.
The agenda. Let's start with the news.
Hi, hon. How's it going?
We must have piles and piles of news since we haven't met for weeks.
Piles and piles. Couple of deaths. There's probably plenty more. But, we had Alan Parker pass away a couple of weeks ago, didn't we? So yeah. Alan Parker, the director of Mississippi's Burning, Fame,
Midnight Express.
Yeah, The Wall, Commitments.
Avita.
And a film that I've always dearly loved, Angel Heart, which
I thought
is a film
you were
that we need to
see
Alone.
At some point. Angel Heart.
I was in both of them.
Angel Heart, yeah. Mickey Rourke and Robert De Niro. Great film.
Wyndham, who did you play in Bugsy Malone?
Who do you think I played in Bugsy Malone?
Fat Sam.
Knuckles.
I played Bugsy Malone.
You?
I love that man. Bugsy Malone.
Well, I've directed two versions of Bugsy Malone over the years, and both have been an absolute disaster.
Did you get your custard on?
Huh?
It's all about the custard, right?
Oh,
Splurge guns.
Yeah, it wasn't the technical thing. It was just the talent, I think. Certainly wasn't my directing. That was perfect.
It was very much the reviews of my Bugsy Malone as well.
Right, so, well, my news is a little bit out of date.
No, I don't have any news.
Okay. Laurie, did you know, are you aware of the significance of the droids in Star Wars?
What?
C-3PO and R2-D2.
Suitably broad question.
Based on Kurosawa's...
Well, they're like, Well, no. See, what I realised, because I watched them all in order about a couple of weeks ago. Most of them are shit, by the way, I have to say. Little reprieve in the middle. Starts bad, ends awful. But C-3PO was owned and created by Anakin, and R2-D2 was owned by Padme.
It's all a load of... That's just a load of bollocks.
Oh.
Yeah, I know that is now in legend.
Well, Anakin did create C-3PO, no, didn't he?
No.
He did in the film.
Yeah, I know.
That amazing film.
No, but no.
Yeah.
See, that's why I can remain still a fan, because I don't let that crap get to me.
So which ones do you believe in?
What do I believe?
The first three.
Yeah, I believe that they're droids, and, you know, R2 was part of, you know, Leia's, you know, entourage. And
but before Leia, what did he do?
What do you mean, what did he do? He took the plans down to the rebels, didn't he? But they're just a couple of droids, rebel droids that get caught up in the hubbub, and then they become more and more important as we go from there. But all that Anakin made C-3PO, it's just all like into bread. It's a wonder that any of the characters have any fingers left by like the last film.
And Alec Guinness doesn't remember owning any droids.
No.
Exactly,
because
he didn't.
Technically, he didn't, because C-3PO was owned by Anakin, and R2-D2 was owned by Padme.
It sounded like you said Auntie D2. Is that what Padme used to call him? Oh, it's Auntie D2.
Anyway, that's my bit of news. Anyone else?
Yeah. Well, there is another death.
Oh God.
'Tis the season to be John Saxon. So, obviously, the dad in Nightmare on Elm Street did loads of stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Brilliant. Enter the Dragon. Stuff.
Battle Beyond the Stars.
That's it. Very important. Did a lot of sort of like Italian sort of films with Mario Bava, Argento. He worked with him. So, he's quite like solid actor. So,
yeah, he was a demon, wasn't he? I think.
He was in who?
Maybe he wasn't. I can't remember.
I don't think he was in Demons, no.
No.
He might as well have been. He was in Starsky and Hutch.
Oh, my gosh. I've got so many terrible films I want to talk about. All right. Shall we get on with In the Beam?
All right.
Wyndham, why don't you kick us off?
In the Beam. All right. So I watched a Netflix original.
Oh.
Which is... a film adaptation of a graphic novel called The Old Guard.
Oh.
It's got Charlize Theron in it, and essentially it is about a group of immortal assassins, and periodically a new assassin is born or attains immortality through the crucible of death.
Would that not result in a world full of assassins if they're all immortal, eventually?
No, well, so it's one of those kind of yin-yang, eternal balances things. So when you need another comes up. And when you don't need them, they don't, you know, you get one every few hundred years, something like that. But it's one of those films, I'm not going to tell you anything about the plot, but it's one of those films where because it's a Netflix original, you kind of go, you never know. Louise and I watched it together, and throughout it's a thoroughly enjoyable watch. It's not going to kind of revolutionise anything, but it is really, it's well cast, it's well acted, it's well written, it's pacey, it's a good effort, and they've evidently left it open to sequels. I don't know whether there are any other graphic novels, but exactly. But it's really well worth a watch.
Okay, I might check that out.
Theron is, she is a lady. She
really is.
Amazon lady.
I quite liked her in Monster.
She's brilliant. She's just great at everything she turns her hand to, and this is no exception.
What was it called again?
The Old Guard.
The Old Guard. Available on Netflix.
Yeah, I'll have a little chew on that.
Okay. I saw a film called The Devil's Reign. When I was told about this film, because our mutual friend Vicky I watched it with her. I thought it was rains as in rains on a horse. But no, it's rain as in falls from heaven.
Precipitation?
Yeah. It's basically about a devil cult, but really. But it had... Who was in it? Sorry, it's been such a long time since I've watched it.
You really seem to have lost energy for this already.
It's
the devil's cult.
Devil's
cult.
Rain, as devil's in pitter-patter.
Yes, the devil's rain. It had John Travolta was in it, but unfortunately, he didn't have any eyes, so you couldn't really tell it was him. Let's see. There was someone very famous in it, so I just need to remind myself who that is.
Oh, it's back. It's from 1975.
Yes.
Oh, wow.
William Shatner is in it.
That's the one. William Shatner.
Ernest Borgnine.
No, just William Shatner.
Wow.
Yeah,
it's got Tom Skerritt in it as well.
Yes. Yeah, from that film about the planes, Top Gun.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
But no, it's brilliant. It was really very good. Never heard of it before, and it's one of those films that kind of hits the ground running. Like, it starts and you're like right in the middle of the action. It's like, oh, great.
And how does our Shatner do? Does he do all right?
Yeah, he's great, isn't he? He's
Is he playing William Shatner? This is before he became William Shatner, really, though, didn't he? Or has he always been William Shatner?
He's always been William Shatner.
Yeah, but it was before he became too extreme. It was before his... What was he, T.J. Hooker?
He was, yeah. T.J. Hooker. That's the 80s right there.
Yeah, so it was in between Star Trek and T.J. Hooker.
Can we have a little bit of Wandering Star from Shat?
What now?
Can we have a little bit of Wandering Star from
Shat? No, stop
Come
doing
on.
That. No, you're banned from making me put any edits into this episode. I'm trying to cook a roast chicken.
Come on, we love a bit of that. Oh, I'm doing one of them as well.
Might have been better.
Oh. I'm having leftovers.
Oh.
Typical.
Anyway,
on a kind of a similar vein where, you know, it's not going to change the world, it's not deep and meaningful. It wasn't too long ago I saw this thing called Blood Machines, which is on another streaming service called Shudder. They're just three very short little episodes, but it's kind of very, very nuanced, stylistic kind of cyberpunk sci-fi stuff. And they kind of turned me on to kind of looking in darker corners, as it were. And I bumped into this film called Space Detective, made in 2017 by a dude called Antonio Lapur. And it's I suppose if you kind of like, you remember like Max Headroom?
Yeah.
Remember that? Max Headroom, or kind of a little bit Sin City, kind of a little bit very indie, kind of something that you would have seen on Liquid TV. You remember Liquid TV by
MTV? We remember all these things.
Yeah. Anyway, again, super stylistic, very low budget, indie film.
What's it about?
It's about kind of, well, it's about this exiled space detective that comes back and takes on a case for his old flame, then gets caught up in intergalactic gangsters, and there's the threat to the galaxy and the solar system. And it's like that. And it's really great. It's really good fun. The palette of it is all really lo-fi special effects, really, and all the colors are just it's all primary colors, so yeah, it's really good fun. I enjoyed it.
Is animation
so it's live acting, but because there's like a hardcore filter on the image, so you can only see like primary color or stark white and black, so that's kind of like the Sin City kind of thing.
Yeah, because none very of on IMDb budget. On IMDb, none of the cast have their pictures on it.
Yeah, it's really...
That's a good sign.
Space Detective.
Great.
Really, I thoroughly enjoyed it. It just reminds me of those old kind of...
Like detective private eye things, but in space.
But yeah, just very sort of lo-fi and, fun, creative, good.
Brilliant.
Nice.
All right. Let's go on the rocks. Love on the rocks. Ain't no surprise. So, on the rocks is our recommendations to not watch, basically. Wyndham, go on, kick us off.
I've actually been watching a lot less shit recently. I've finally taken it upon myself to take your instructions on board. That said, I did watch Strippers versus Werewolves.
Right.
Which I was staggered to find out is a pile of poo. Right. It's just one of those really low budget British films where it's just crappy. It's just terrible. There's, as the title would suggest, there's an eternal battle between strippers and werewolves.
A bit like,
or rather, a particular strip club and its strippers and a particular pack of werewolves. It's got who's the Spandau Ballet dude?
Mark Kemp.
One of the brothers. Kemp. The other one.
Gary Ryan. Kemp.
Oh no, it is Martin Kemp. Sorry, it is Martin Kemp. He's in it. And some other people are in it. It's just bad. It can't quite get. It's trying to be really kind of kitschy and really deliberately a bit naff, and it doesn't quite get any of those things right. It's just shit.
So let's talk about the strippers. Is it a mix of male and ladies?
No, of course not.
Just straight.
It's just
male.
The ladies.
Oh,
yeah. No wang.
The werewolves are all men, are they?
Quite right, yeah. Yeah, and they all peer through these holes as the strippers get checked. It's just really shit. It's just terrible. It's terrible. Don't watch it. Not that you would, given what it's called, but I just want to make sure.
No, not that you would. We bumped into, so it was one of those days, what do you want to watch, baby? I said, I don't know, darling. This is me talking to the albatross. And we plumbed for Gemini Man.
Oh, no.
Oh, have you seen it? I thought you might may have seen this before. So you got your Will Smith, your Willie Smith. You think, yeah, no, he'd be all right.
Oh, well, he plays a clone of his younger self.
He does. Yeah, as it starts, he is kind of looking after you. It's okay. But then you do meet the clone. It's a John Woo film. And it's just, oh, man, it's tits. So there you are. That's about it, really.
Yeah.
I'll tell you a bit. It reminds me of a bit of news. They are making a motion picture of The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air.
They are. Yeah.
And I saw the trailer. And the trailer looks really good. It's serious, Wind. I'm sure it's got a bit of comedy in there, but it's certainly not got a laughter track. But yeah, it looks quite good.
Huh.
So there you go.
Is it a direct lift of the characters from the TV show?
Yes, otherwise.
Or is it? No. But my point
Uncle
is
Phil's in it. Yeah, they're all.
Are
in
they
it.
Recreating the TV show, or is it, as you say, a more serious version of?
That's exactly
social
what
mobility
said.
Or something.
It's a more serious version.
I know.
Yeah, that but all terrible. The all the characters are there. It's gonna be great.
I wonder if you're gonna get that Colton dance.
All right, so I was gonna talk about Fantasy Island, but I'm not, because I watched a film this morning. Which I was really excited about watching, because I heard about it. It's called Little Joe. You heard about it?
No.
Okay, so it's the premise is this greenhouse laboratory invent this new plant, and they nickname it Little Joe. And it's basically Invasion of the Body Snatchers. It gives off the pollen, makes people just obsessed with looking after the plant. So it's a really good premise, just right on my street. But the acting, Jessica Hausner, who's won loads of awards, made the actors do such an effective performance. There's like full of pinter pauses and awkward bits and bad hair. What? And it's just awful. I mean, it's more or less unwatchable. And it's kind of like, it's like when we were at college, Wynn, really.
Oh, dear.
Yeah.
They're trying to get all arty with...
Yeah, and some of it's obviously semi-improvised, and it's just cringeworthy. I mean, it's awful, because the premise is really good.
Is it a modern film?
Yeah.
Yeah, last year.
Yeah. But yeah, really disappointing.
So you don't think it's done? No. Emily Beecham, Ben Whishaw, Kerry Fox, or Kit Connor? Any
love Ben
big
Whishaw
boosts?
Yeah. But no, they're all being shown how to act really badly. No, it's like they're all in on this secret, but they haven't bothered to share it with the audience. So I thought it was terrible, terrible.
Little bollock Joe. Huh.
There we go. Right.
Poor little Joe.
So we are going to move on to the final section of Wise by Name, What the Fuck by Nature.
Ooh.
Seems like this has been going on for years, not 3 months, doesn't it? So the last little delicacy you gave us, Laurie, was Sorry to Bother You.
That's it, yeah. So sort of out of the three, well, I don't know, it's not massively what the fucky. Fairly recent film, I think, what was it? 2017?
Yeah.
Something like that. So you've got
2018,
yeah. So Boots Riley, it's his baby, and I thought, yeah, you might quite enjoy it. What were your thoughts,
James?
Well, the word I wrote down was brilliant, but I think that was at the end when I watched it at the end, because I'm now remembering the start. It was a bit like climbing up a hill. I was quite bored for the first bit. But I think it took me a while to get into the kind of flavour of the film.
Yeah.
It's very stylized. You know, I didn't really think much of his girlfriend, and then it clicked into place, and it was like with the earrings and what she was trying to achieve and stuff, and it just got better and better and better. And when the whole
thing turned up,
I just thought, oh, fucking hell, this is brilliant.
Yeah. So I have to disagree with you, Laurie. I think it absolutely sits in the what? Because
yeah. Okay.
It is super weird, but I agree with James, actually, that first kind of 25 minutes, because it starts with this guy trying to get a job, and he's lying his way into a job. It's a call center job. You're having to sell some crap that nobody needs to some people who don't need it, right?
Telesales,
and it's this massive global corporation that seems to have cornered the market in everything that anybody could ever need. And the guy getting the job is an actor called Lakeith Stanfield. He plays a character called Cassius Green. And he's trying to flog this stuff and it's not working. And his line is, sorry to bother you.
Yeah.
And then they hang up on him. And sat next to him in this little kind of telesales farm is Danny Glover, who's been there forever. And he says, No. You need to whiten up your voice.
Use your white voice.
And they suddenly come up with these kind of real, real tweezy, tweaky white person's voice.
And it does seem, it does sound very
absolute fake. Killing.
I find it very
it
hard.
It does sound very fake, but and it's all it's yeah. It's I'm trying to think. It's that proper kind of the way they portray American white frat houses, that kind of stuff. That those kind of but he ends up he's trying to get ahead in life, and in order to do that, the premise is he basically has to denounce the people are his brothers and sisters and people of his socioeconomic level to get elevated into the superstardom role, where he
power
then finds out
or whatever it is.
Power caller. Yeah.
Power caller, yeah. Where you're selling whatever the services of this company are to governments and other big corporations and stuff like that. I can't remember how much we spoil things in this. Quite a lot, right?
Yeah, let's not spoil it too much. Because...
Well, yeah. So, like, power caller, you're now selling, like, nuclear weapons and planes. And
yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. And he gets on because he's perfected this white person's voice. But then he very quickly becomes aware that he's still viewed as the kind of, he's not the token black man, because there's another guy who kind of manages them all, but it's very much the case of do what we tell you to do and everything will be fine for you, challenge us, yeah, and it won't be. And yeah, after about half an hour,
the way the film sort of evolves and just moves on. So I mean, even right at the beginning, you've got the whole the TV adverts, like, I got the shit kicked out of me. everyone watches that TV show where people just get their basically the shit kicked out of them. And then there's like that those adverts for the worry-free living. So basically slavery, but you get 3 meals a day. So it's kind of like, oh, that could be quite pleasant.
And all your accommodation, yeah.
So it's a very surreal world that you're already in. But I found it right from the beginning very funny. So it kind of hooked me straight away. But as the film evolves, so yeah, like you say, it's kind of that greasy pole, you know, trying to get up there, that capitalism satire stuff, and what you've got to do to screw over your brother to get back to that point. But then again, the film keeps going. It keeps getting more adventurous and weirder. And it's just, it's beautiful. It's really great. And like I say, this guy that made it, Boots Riley, it was his real prop. It's been going on for years. He started it off as a song. Then it was like, I think it went to a script. They made an album of it. And then I think it was Sundance Studios. They're like, this is a really good idea. So they wanted to make sure that the film is just right. And I think it's just a little gem. It's a little lovely, great film. Really adventurous, weird, funny. And it was very political as well, obviously. I think it's great. I loved it.
I agree. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, me too. So thank you very much, Laurie. Your
pleasure.
Your services are no longer required.
Yeah.
And even though you didn't ask, I think I'd give it an 8 out of 10.
Okay.
Yeah, I think I'd give it a 7.
Whoa!
Yeah. Only because I was a bit bored at the start.
It's not boring at the start.
Well, I've found it boring.
It's not.
Don't listen, Jim, listeners.
All right, let's move on to our feature, which is my golden ticket. Hey!
Because I've got a golden ticket. I've got a golden ticket. I've got a golden chance to make my way. And with a golden ticket, it's a golden day.
Yay!
Okay, so, I got to choose two of my favourite films to talk about. So, let's crack on. Shall we start with...
Where do you want to start, James?
Let's start with Requiem for a Dream, I think, and finish on something a bit lighter.
Okay,
so let me give you a little bit of information about it. So it was released in 2000. The director is Darren Aronofsky. It was written by Hubert Selby, the music by Clint Mansell. It had a budget of $4.5 million, and the box office it made $7.4 million.
All right.
No sequels or spin-offs, and no collectors. What?
I'm just thinking of the spin-off.
What the sequel or the spin-off?
Top shelf stuff.
Ellen Bernstein plays Sarah Goldfarb. Jared Leto, Harry Goldfarb. Jennifer Connelly as Marion Silver and Marlon Wayans as Tyrone C. Love. Shall we have a clip?
I like the way I feel. Now when I get the sun, I smile. I'm gonna be on television.
Okay.
Is that one of the brighter moments we slipped?
Yeah.
Okay, so what did you think? Have either of you seen this before?
Yeah, so I think I saw it probably, soon after it came out on DVD, I suppose. And I did, no, actually I may have bumped into it on TV. Oh, actually I can't even remember. I think it must have been DVD. But yeah, I remember really enjoying it because of, I suppose, at the time, kind of the use of edits and the sort of playfulness that the film does with, you know, slow time sequencing or fast time or, I thought that was really interesting. And I suppose the way that you get sucked into the story as well, you start following, obviously, what happens.
We'll get on to that in a minute. I just asked if you'd seen it. Wyndham.
Yes, I've seen it. I enjoyed it.
No, I hadn't seen it.
So what?
When I mentioned to Louisa that you'd picked your golden ticket and we're going to do this film, she said, "Do you know what? I probably won't watch that one with you." It's a hell of a watch, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, it is. First impressions were, oh my God. I'd kind of been a bit pre-warned that it was going to be a little bit of a challenging watch.
Was that Laurie's before and after Photoshop that he posted? So, yeah, he did.
I don't think I saw it.
He did a picture of the character at the start of the film and a picture of the characters at the end of the
film. Oh, yeah.
Bit of a spoiler there, Laurie, really.
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah, watched it, enjoyed it as much as I think you can. But to your point, Laurie, I think all of that kind of, it's really stylized and there are bits of it. It's just a really interesting film as well as being brilliantly acted, brilliantly written, brilliantly constructed. Yeah, it's a really good watch.
I suppose those sort of techniques that he uses, it's almost kind of like the squeeze of lime or the mixer with it, because it's actually, you know, it's really dark and it's not actually, this second time I watched it, it's not particularly pleasurable. However, it kind of is. It kind of is. It's still kind of fun. It's kind of that sweetener, as it were, because of it that serality, I suppose, for want of a better word, it kind of gives it. It's not, because you could go really dark, it could be really serious, it could be just an absolute nightmare, which it is a nightmare, but it's kind of, it eases off it with that, because you've got that surrealism kind of element to it, so and kind I of take the edge off.
I guess those like little tricks that he used weren't around.
Yeah, so, yeah. They're
now kind of adopted into the mainstream quite a lot, you know, lots of split camera and stuff. Like, there's a really nice bit where Jared and Jennifer Connelly are lying in bed together, and they've got two cameras, one on each, and they're focusing on different parts, but it's just lovely. I mean, I love this film. I think it's an amazing piece of work, if not a little depressing.
Yeah. When did you first see it?
In 2003. I wasn't having an exceptionally good time myself, really. I think I watched it about 10 times on a loop.
Wow.
Yeah, but I've loved it ever since. Let's talk a little bit about the actors. Alan Bernstein, amazing. Yeah.
Pow!
Yeah.
She is amazing. Yeah. So she plays Sarah Goldfarb, who is Harry, Jared Leto's character's mother. And she's that kind of long suffering, the husband's not around. She's that kind of long suffering, low life expectation mother, desperately trying to do what she can, but her son keeps selling the telly so he can buy drugs. And,
that's the opening scene. And I think you've got like, for me, it's one of those things that all kind of come together. So you've got the brilliant acting between the two of them when he's trying to take that TV. You feel the threat and you feel the love of the mother. You've got that split screen thing going on. And it's focused on her face and her worry and concern for her son and her TV. And then it bangs into that music, which again has been taken over by the zeitgeist, hasn't it? I mean, I think it did the X Factor and stuff like that. But the power of that music and the shots and stuff, you're just, for me, I was just gripped from the start.
Yeah, it is gripping. And the level of acting is superb. Going back to Bernstein's character, though, I mean, yeah, it's just heartbreaking, isn't it? Obviously, she loves her son, she's lonely, but then she gets that call saying,
"That's so cruel, is it? That they never call her back."
And it's her little dream, or it's just not a crank call, but it's a lie, isn't it? Whatever it's called, spam.
I think. They were serious. I think it was the TV station. And I think whatever happened, she just never got the follow-up information.
Oh, really? I thought it was just a lie. I thought it was a scam or something. But no, for that, so she needs to lose a little bit of weight. So she quite innocently goes in. One of her mates say, "Hey, go to this doctor. He'll sort you out. You'll lose weight." Get into a nice fancy red dress that she wore.
I don't know if you noticed that scene with the doctor, but he was directed specifically not to make any eye contact with her.
No eye contact at all. Yeah, he doesn't care who she is. He gives her dodgy pills that basically make her go mental.
So this film's really about addiction, isn't it?
Yeah. Various forms. I've put within the first kind of 10 minutes, I've got drugs, diet, desperation, trapped.
Yeah.
But her whole kind of story, and it is just that kind of you feel really sorry for her to begin with, and then because she's dealing with this errant son who's got his own significant problems, and then the one kind of shining light, she watches TV all day, and the one shining light is she can get on this program, but she can't quite get an address, and then these drugs are just prescribed to her without any kind of investigation or whether they're relevant or pertinent or whatever, and then she just becomes addicted to those and increases the dose. And it just, her descent, talk about performances, that is pretty fucking powerful stuff.
By far the best performance. There's and there's a bit where their worlds collide, I guess, isn't it? When Harry is doing pretty well and he goes to visit his mother. Yeah. And she's all very chatty and he's looking at her and the camera's focusing on her, and then it kind of swings round. So it goes from the light round to the dark, and he realises that her teeth are chattering, and he goes, "Ma, you're an uppers, Ma." I think that's kind of the beginning of the end, really.
Yeah. He buys her, like, probably the worst thing he ever could buy her, this huge, ginormous TV, this behemoth of massive speakers that just kind of becomes this monster to her. But yeah, Jared Leto. So I'd say, to be honest, I suppose most of the films Jared Leto's in, he twists my dick a bit, but he's really super young in this one, looking beautiful, like very elfin. At the beginning of the film, you know, he's kind of bright and all that. And like you say, you know, he gets to a point where he's doing well. Him and his mate are doing well. They have a bit of, they dabble in the druggage, but, you know, they kind of got it under wraps. But then it unfortunately takes that turn into the addiction and stuff. It gets worse and worse and worse. And he does really, really good in this film. And again, just a really sad story. Because there's a scene actually directly after that scene that you say where he realizes that she's on these uppers and stuff, but he realizes she's just lonely and she misses her son. But, you know, in reality, people get to points in life where they do leave. We do leave our mothers and we do miss our sons and stuff like that. But he can't go back there. And he's in the car, basically. He starts crying and all that. But yeah, really, really great. And then obviously we've got the, what's her name? Young girl? Yeah.
From Labyrinth.
Marion.
From Labyrinth.
God, she's been around a long time.
Yeah, she has, hasn't she? And she's worked with Aronofsky quite a bit because she's, when I say quite a bit, after watching this film, to take the edge off, I watched Noah, or The Beginning of Noah.
Oh, God.
You ever seen that?
Yeah.
No.
They look like mental. The Bible. They've got rock monsters in it.
Yeah, I know.
It's ridiculous.
She's in that, but yeah.
But yeah, I mean, again, brilliant performance and just a horrible decline. You know, I mean, the worst scene for me by far is the bit at the end where she's trying to find out where Harry is and he's not going to be coming back anytime soon. And she's
got
the number of that guy and, you know, she ends up in that.
Yeah.
Oh, ass to ass, baby, ass to ass. I just think it's horrible.
It's a very pessimistic film, and it's just kind of that sort of modern day nightmare.
Don't take drugs.
Don't do drugs.
Just don't do
drugs. I mean, if you do them, do the good ones.
Yeah.
Not the really shit ones.
Can we just talk a little bit about Marlon Wayans as well? Because he's a comedian, but I think, you know, and this was his...
Well, and he and his brothers, so there's Marlon, Damon, I want to say that, well, I think there are four of them.
Right.
Apologies, can't remember.
A bit like the McGanns.
The other one. But they're known, yeah, but they're known for the Scary Movie.
Oh, right,
franchise.
That's him.
So they took Scream and turned it into kind of Scary
of
Movie
course,
and stuff
him,
like that.
Isn't it?
So they, and they're all individually successful, you know. Damon Wayans was. No. I'm just saying that whenever I see the fact that a Wayans is in it, I'm expecting something a bit shit. Because it normally is a bit shit. But he's excellent in this as well. It's a proper.
Yeah.
He's a really good sidekick to Jared Leto's character. We're going to say it a lot, but it's just watching the tragedy of these people's lives that they start off as fuck-ups and drug addicts and bouncing around right on the bottom. They then have an idea to do a drug deal themselves, get a kind of a bulk load of drugs, sell it themselves, make a bit more money. And they do. They're successful. They each get an apartment. Marlon Wayans' character has a girlfriend and they're talking about the long-term future and all this kind of stuff. And then there's a gang war which stops the drugs hitting the streets, so nobody's got anything. And they were just managing to temper their addictions with a little bit here and there, and then suddenly their addictions kick back in.
And is that when is that
spending
fall?
The money
I
they've saved?
That's when fall kicks in, isn't it? So it's kind of separated into the seasons, and that music kicks in again, and all turns to shit.
Yeah, and then they go off to do a deal down in Florida, and that is when all of their worlds completely fall apart, and the mother's world completely falls apart, and then it's just like it goes from a gradual descent to a precipitous drop at the end. And Wayans was good. Yeah, I think it's his best performance I've seen him give.
Yeah. Location as well, that kind of worked for me because I love Coney Island. I've only ever been once years ago when I was in New York, but like that whole kind of rundown American seaside resort. It's a perfect setting, really.
Because
I love all the women sitting out at the front of the apartment in their little armchair. Well,
with their little reflectors to get sun there is.
I love
there
that.
There are some light moments. There's not many, but when she dyes her hair red, and if this orange is like if this is red, what's orange?
Yeah, it's really cool.
Yeah.
It makes you think, though. I mean, it is. I suppose if you kind of sort of learn some lessons, obviously one, definitely don't do drugs. That's one.
Yeah.
But just hold dear, kind of those relationships and that, because crap can easily start creeping in and crap can start falling to pieces. So just, I don't know what the hell I'm talking about, but hold the good stuff precious and don't let it go.
Absolutely.
Definitely.
All right. Memorable scene. I'm going to say her walking around in a red dress, I think. But, she, as good as they all are, she is just remarkably good in this.
The drugs she's on and the diet she is on really start messing with her, and she starts hallucinating about the TV and about the fridge and all this kind of stuff. And the TV company are not getting back to her. So eventually she goes to the TV program, to the station, to get them to tell her when she's going to be on TV. Wow. And her trip on the tube, what's it called in America? Not the underground. Subway, thank you. The subway, and then being in the TV station, and then the escalation of her treatment when she gets sectioned, essentially. When she's in the hospital, I think she's magnificent all the way through, but that for me is a really strong, memorable scene where they start giving her electroshock therapy and all that kind of stuff. It's so fucked up.
I think mine is actually before she's even on the druggers. She's just really hungry, and then she looks at like the mantelpiece, and the way that I think Wile E. Coyote may look at Roadrunner, and then sometimes Roadrunner turns into a nice, beautiful roast Roadrunner with those little white socks on his legs. She looks at like this shell that's on the mantelpiece and it turns into a steaming hamburger. And then I think she looks at, like, I don't know, a pair of socks. It turns into a nice ham sandwich. I like that bit.
Yeah, brilliant. Does it stand up today?
Yeah.
I think some of the camera techniques were feel a little dated, but I think it's just because it's been overused a lot.
It does, yeah, a little bit. And you, like you say, yeah, it's because it's been... lots of things have kind of been inspired by it, I suppose, and using those techniques and ideas. And that tune is a really, really cool tune, but, oh, you know what I mean? It's kind of, it's been stolen. It's been corrupted now.
Yeah. Memorable lines?
There's one where Tyrone, Marlon Wayans' character, is doing a drug deal, and they're in the limo, and the driver drops the window between the driver and the body of the limo. All the guys in the back are black, and as the window goes down, Marlon Wayans goes, "Oh shit, you've got a white driver," as if like that's the pinnacle, and then everybody starts getting shot and it all kind of falls to shit.
Yes. Laurie?
I don't know. It would be one of Ellen's lines, but yeah, it's just that, I suppose it would be a sassy kind of line between her and her mate, I suppose, those kind of bits.
All right. Shall we
start? We haven't spoken about Jennifer Connelly particularly.
Have we not? She's kind of like the rich girl, isn't she? But unfortunately, her addiction gets more and more and more. But, you know, she's very in love with our young guy. They have their dreams. And then getting back to that.
It's beautiful, those scenes where they're together and, you know, on the top of the block of flats and stuff like that. It's lovely.
And they want to open a shop or a... She's a designer, yeah. A clothes designer, isn't she?
Yeah.
And they've kind of got this future, which the original drug deal looks like it's going to help realise... but she's also a user, initially not quite to the same degree as Jared and Harry and Tyrone. But when there's kind of like this embargo on drugs on the street, she starts losing it. And when Harry goes, she's let... I know he asks her to... She'd been seeing this guy.
Oh, God, that's horrible, that bit. Yeah.
So essentially trading sex for money. And he's an awful human being. And Harry, her boyfriend, persuades her to go and see this guy. She doesn't want to go. She wants to just kind of, it's fine, we'll cope. But Harry said, no, but if we don't have this nest egg, then we can't move forward. So that kind of is the first real fracture that is really going to cause her demise. And it just is horrific. The pace of the demise in all of these characters is just... I know it's done over a year, but it's a fucking hell.
Yeah.
Crikey. James Golden Ticket.
Let's score it.
And actually, the final scene...
I need a pen.
The most memorable scene for me is the very final scene where she has... Yes. So she's been to see this guy. She then... There's rumour that this other guy has some drugs, but he doesn't trade it for money. He trades it for sexual performances, essentially. So he runs sex parties for rich white guys, effectively. And the way he gets the women to perform in those sex parties is through their drug addiction. So she goes, she can't cope. She wants Harry to come back. He's been arrested, so he can't. And you kind of get the feeling that if he could have got back, then
yeah, he could have saved that.
There might have been a glimmer of hope, but it wasn't. So she phones this guy, performs at this party, and then at the end, when you see all the characters in their final state, so Harry's had injected some bad drugs and has lost an arm. Marlon has been imprisoned and is essentially working a chain gang. Sarah is in a mental hospital and there's no way she's getting out. And then Marion just comes back from this awful party and just kind of curls up on the sofa and looks at the drugs she's been given in payment and then smiles. That's the way she smiles at her drugs and hugs her drugs. It's like, oh my God.
Right, come on.
Happy now, James? Are you happy?
Drugs.
Are you happy with this?
Let's do it. Performances, Laurie.
I'm going eight. Sorry.
Wyndham.
Nine.
And it's 10 for me. Effects, Wyndham.
Seven.
Eight.
Seven for me. Laurie.
Eight.
Great. Plot, nine for me. Laurie.
Seven.
Win.
Seven.
Rewatch factor, Laurie.
Surprisingly, it's because of the technique of the film and all that. It's I'm going six.
Punchy. I'm going to have to give it a two because it is a pretty tough watch.
Well, obviously, it's a 10 for me as soon as I watched it again and again. Direction, Win.
Eight.
Nine.
Eight.
Cinematography, eight.
Eight.
Nine.
Sound and music, Laurie.
Seven.
I went nine.
Nine for me. Originality, Wyndham.
Six.
Ten.
You kind of see this story in like Kathy Come Home or all sorts of things, or Silly Cow or whatever it's called. Seven.
Enjoyability. seven.
Five.
Seven.
And life-changing past or present, it gets a 10 from me.
I'm going to have to give it a zero just because I saw it for the first time a few weeks ago. But
had I seen it when I was younger?
Did it change my life? Well, I already kind of was of the opinion, don't do drugs.
Okay, fair enough. Laurie?
I'd say sort of four.
All right. Okay, so that makes my grand total 89.
Punchy, I give it a 62.
I'm going to give it, or I have given it, 70.
Okay, so what does that 70. Work
out? Giving it a grand score of 73.6 recurring until you get to a 7.
Okay. Okay, so that puts it above Dead Man's Shoes, but below Battle Royale on our 2020 leaderboard. And what was it, 73.6? It puts it just below The Dark Crystal and The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, but above Starship Troopers. Quite admirable. 13th place. That's all right.
It's difficult to know quite where it belongs because it is a really good film. It's just not a particularly bouncy, enjoyable film.
All right. Right, well, let's move on then to my second choice, which was...
Which couldn't be more similar.
Picture Show. All right, so let me give you some information about it. It was released in 1975. Director, Jim Sharman. Screenplay and music by Richard O'Brien. It had a budget of $1.4 million. And it has so far made $140.2 million.
Yeah!
It is very successful. One sequel, Shock Treatment, which is a terrible film in my opinion. And the cast, we have seen Tim Curry as Dr. Frankenfurter. Susan Sarandon as Janet Weiss.
Come on!
Barry Bostwick as Brad Majors. Richard O'Brien as Riff Raff. Patricia Quinn as Magenta. Neil Campbell as Columbia. Jonathan Adams as Dr. Everett Scott. Peter Hinwood as Rocky. Meatloaf as Eddie. And Charles Gray as the criminologist.
So, and it's also got Christopher Biggins.
Christopher Biggins, exactly. Yeah. Good measure.
Okay, so let's have a clip.
My feet! I can't move my feet!
My wheels! I gotta care for my wheels.
It's as if we're glued to the spot. You are so quick with fear, you tiny fools.
We're trapped.
something you'll get used to. A mental mindfuck can be nice.
You won't find Earth people quite the easy mark you imagine. This sonic transducer, it is, I suppose, some kind of audio vibratory physiomolecular transport device.
You mean?
Yes, Brad. It's something we ourselves have been working on for quite some time. But it seems our friend here has found a means of perfecting it. A device which is capable of breaking down solid matter and then projecting it through space and who knows, perhaps even time itself.
You mean he's gonna send us to another planet?
Planet! Schmanet! Janet!
And Laurie, I forgot to do this last time, but do it now. Give us the synopsis.
Oh shit. Okay, so you've got your pop art, Brad and Janet. They've attended a wedding. Is it her sister? I can't fully remember.
No, it's his best mate, I think.
Best mate at a wedding. And then they're driving, and then the car goes tits up, and then there's a light in a window at a house over there. It's a castle. It's a Transylvanian castle. And the castle is run by a scientist who's created a monster. And he flies his freak flag. And
all right, that'll do.
Crazy shit goes down.
All right, so it's a musical based on, like, the B-movies of the 40s and 50s with a kind of sexual twist, I guess.
Yeah. You'd far better than me.
Have you seen it before?
I had not seen it before, no.
So,
I know.
What did you
do? I don't know why. So I watched it after Requiem for a Dream, so I was very pleased. It's a somewhat lighter touch than Requiem for a Dream. Overall, I really enjoyed it. It's just pretty bonkers. Considering it was made back in 1975, the whole context of this film is massively challenging for that era. All of the ideas in it are just crazy for an audience in 1975. Really thoroughly enjoyed it.
Brilliant. I'm pleased to
didn't really
it.
Understand it, but I did enjoy it.
I saw it for the first time when I think I was about 12 or 13.
Perfect.
I remember being deeply disturbed by it and then watching it like the next day again. And then just fall in love with it completely. I mean, I've never seen anything like this before in my young age. And it's brilliant. You know, well, Laurie, what about you?
Yeah, so back in the day, it was probably about 16, something like that. And my heart had been stolen by an actress, and it still currently is. And her troupe said, right, we're going up to London, we're going to the Prince Charles Theatre to watch the Rocky Horror Picture Show. And I was like, oh, shut up, get off. And they're like, go and dress up like a girl in suspenders. I'm like, shut up, get off.
So was this a stage show or was it a film?
This was the film, but you get, because obviously this
were the people at the front acting?
Yeah, this film is such a thing. It's become, it's a thing. Anyway, so I went up and I went as far as wearing a suede jacket. That's the extent that I went. Everyone else on the minibus were like wearing, garters, corsets, suspenders, all sorts of stuff. And this is completely including the guys. You know, this is the film that you go to wearing a dress, legit. And this is why this film is so important, because it's literally like, you can be whatever you want to be and be insanely cool at exactly the same time. So anyway,
dream it, be it.
Yeah, don't dream it, be it. And went into the cinema, and like I say, this thing has become such a thing. So I'm watching the film. It's the first time I've ever seen it. But the crowd are sort of shouting out the certain bits where, like, Brad bangs on the dashboard of the car. And just before he does that, it's like, don't kill the fly or kill the fly or they all shout out.
And when Janet comes on, they go, slut, whore.
Yeah, 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 yeah. So this whole, it's just this whole new
whole load of stuff.
Oh my God, this is gorgeous. So super, and like you say, 1975, I mean, what a wonderful, wonderful thing. Just like, you know, like I say, fly your freak flag and be proud of it and do it cool. And Tim Curry is just such a, anyway, So yeah, I absolutely loved it. I loved it, loved it, loved it. And it's grown and grown and grown more. And this viewing now, we watched it with our family. So the little Sienna, she's what, 5? Roman's 10. But I know it's gender bendy and got some, you know, naughty, saucy stuff in it, but it's just great. It's just great fun and important.
Brilliant. Yeah. Well, go on. Sorry, James.
Yeah, no, I finished. Brilliant. What was
the lips, I was just gonna say, right at the beginning. I mean, how, what is as cool as that?
Yeah.
Those lips and that voice. Oh. And then Ricana, and it's just, delicious. And then you've got the guy that played the onion, the criminologist.
Criminologist.
Does he look like an onion meets an owl?
He's Charles Gray. He's
James Bond, was it?
Loads of stuff. He plays Nazis and stuff like that.
Yeah, and he plays like devil worshippers. The devil rides out.
Wasn't he Blofeld
he was.
Yeah. Roger Moore years. Which is
Diamonds Are Forever.
Yeah, stunning face.
Yeah, Diamonds Are Forever.
What's it called? Gavin and Stacey.
We are.
Yeah.
It, like, Gavin is his spawn, don't you think? Don't worry about it.
What,
he
James
looks like an onion meets an owl.
Oh.
He's great.
So just on that opening song, I think we've talked about it before, but it name checks loads of like B movie sci-fi horror classics. So yeah, a couple of years ago I watched.
And you've done the full tour.
You did,
right?
You've done them all, yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, it's a love letter to all that kind of B movie stuff, really, isn't it? I think.
But completely its own thing. I mean, it's absolutely nothing like any of them.
Well,
I did notice watching this one, like the time warp when Brad and Janet get into the house. The time warp's nice to listen to and to watch, but actually doing it, it's proper shit.
Ah, it's cringeworthy.
Well, so that was the only thing I knew about this film.
The time war.
Well, it's just drunk.
Yeah, essentially. Because of all those horrible uni yeah. drunken, pissed club nights.
Let's do something. Yeah. I noticed as well this time in the car, when Brad and Janet were in the car, and there's just loads of little subtle lines, like when the bikers goes past, and he goes, life's pretty cheap to that sort of Janet.
Yeah.
But there's a Nixon's there on the radio as well, which is quite a nice touch. I've never noticed that before. Let's talk a little bit about the performances. Let's start with Tim Curry.
Jesus. His entrance.
What a performance.
Yeah, his entrance. So the songs, it's fair to say in this film, a lot of musicals sometimes, you know, the songs are kind of just there, just adding, I suppose, but the songs in this film really drive that plot, don't they? It's kind of fair to say that, yeah?
Yeah.
And the entrance of Frankenfurter, Tim Curry, and just that foot, that, you know, that platform, high heel platform shoe.
With the little stars on it.
Just comes down, and you've got Sweet Transvestite. It's just, he's so cool.
Well, he does that.
He didn't play that part.
He can be quite sinister, but very charming and likable.
Yeah.
Well, I've written down channeling Mick Jagger in some of his movements, but he's entirely embodying,
and that's
it requires, and to your point earlier, Laurie, you were saying you can be anything you want to be and be cool, you just have to be it 100%.
And
I think that's true of life, right? You kind of meet someone who's, you can tell they're not quite committing 100% to whatever it is, commits to it, and it goes, fuck you, don't care what you think, this is me. You kind of go, that's amazing, whatever it might be. And this performance is just, he's hot as well.
Yeah.
I had some moments in this film, I'll be honest. It was like, well, you know, I'm open to growth.
And that's the whole gender bendy bit is thing. But Tim Curry, he did say, I mean, we found a little documentary behind the scenes thing. And Tim Curry.
Oh, yeah, that was lovely.
Yeah, he'd been doing this part for like ages at the, you know, in the theatres and stuff. And so when he got to the film, it's properly got into him. He's become it. And he says, obviously, you put the makeup on But at the end of the day, you take it off, but it always remains in the cracks. So he couldn't really quite ever shake it. I think Frankenfurter properly got into him. But you can see it. He is it.
Yeah. So cool. Yeah, he is.
What about Susan Sarandon?
Her bra's too small for her. It keeps riding up at the back. You need a different bra, Susan, but I think she's great.
You know that
she's gorgeous.
You kind of get the feeling, or I got the feeling that Susan and Barry, so Janet and Brad, they're definitely the counterpoint to Frankenfurter, and that they're there to kind of allow him to corrupt their morals and their idea of their sexual identity and all those things. So they're quite wooden is the wrong word. I don't mean wooden. I just mean they're very kind of tightly defined and repressed.
I've got my whole life mapped out.
Deliberately repressed. Absolutely. Yeah. And so when they're kind of playing off, or Frankenfurter is playing off them, it's just the juxtaposition between how he is and how they are, certainly to begin with, is just brilliant. Because you would just be blown away by meeting someone like him. You'd just be like transfixed by him.
And he just disarms, you know, when Brad gets angry at him, and he gets that sort of like, what a fine specimen of a man you are, so dominant. And, you know, Brad's like, well, fuck.
Yeah.
it's brilliant.
Yeah. In his massive wife.
Brad and Janet, they're great. They're hilarious. So funny.
Yeah. And then let's talk Meatloaf. What do we think about his little cameo?
Yeah, well, not a lot. As if there was any irritant, it would be Meatloaf. But he's great. But I noticed in this watch, there's something about... So Frankenfurter said that there was an accident. He found an accident, and then he can create life. But he alludes to that he split Eddie's brain.
Yeah, the idea is that he uses Meatloaf's brain to put into Rocky, basically.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, but I wouldn't take the science too seriously.
Well, I was... for a while. I thought I'd have a go down that route, but I didn't get too far with it.
And then obviously we've got Dr. Scott turning up, which gives way to that brilliant bit where they're all going, Dr. Scott, Rocky, Frank.
I love the bit when he turns up, so he's in the Zen room, isn't he? And Frankenfurter pulls the lever.
Magnetizes him around.
Oh, it's just wonderful. I love seeing fast motion wheelchairs and people sat in them.
Yeah, wonderful, 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 wonderful. And it builds to a brilliant climax. I mean, you know, the floor show at the end. I mean, you've got that brilliant song, Don't Get Hot and Flustered, Use a Bit of Mustard. You're a hot dog. And he reduces them all. But then they do that
crazy. So random.
Yeah.
It is so random, but so brilliant. And you're right,
that's like a breath. It just keeps moving and moving and moving.
I think Richard O'Brien, he'd written like the beginning and the middle and was kind of like performing it. And I think he was using it something to distract him, to keep him away from boredom or whatever. And someone said, this is really great. You should need to figure out an ending. And he said, he admitted he found it very easy. He just went, well, there's the ending. No hassle. There you go, done. And apparently the same with the songs as well. He's got a lot of musician friends. Why did you make it? He said, because I didn't overcomplicate it. It goes like that, and it's a bit of that, and that's that. Apparently, for him.
It seems like such an obvious thing to do at the end when, you know, Frank sings that beautiful song and then they kill him. And Rocky goes mad and climbs up the arcade.
Does King Kong. Yeah.
But it's very sad. I always find it very sad at the end when they're all wandering around singing superheroes, you know, in that shell of where the house was. But, yeah.
Well, the night's over, isn't it? It's just kind of that, you know,
everyone's
back to work.
What do we think
about... Let's do it again next weekend.
What do we think about the effects?
Well, if you're including those red lips... and the fast motion wheelchair.
I suppose the science fiction. Thunderclap. Really.
I think I'm feeling a nine coming.
Aye?
I think a 9 might be coming from me later with regards to the effect. It's a shame we haven't seen Richard in more stuff though, because he's good. He's a good actor. He makes a creepy little. There's something weird about him. Well, he's got that certain, you know, otherness.
For the Crystal Maze.
I can only think of one other film that he's in.
Shock Troop.
Dark City. Have you guys ever seen that? Dark City?
Yeah, I think so, a while ago.
I can't think of anything else he's been in. I want to see more of our Richie. But he's probably knocking on now, isn't he?
Apparently he can go and stay in the castle. I don't know where it is.
That'll be fun.
Hmm. I did notice that almost all the levers on any of the machines appear. Small bell ends on the end.
Yeah, I think they're all dildos, aren't they?
just as an aside, yeah.
Brilliant.
All right. Has anyone got any memorable lines or anything like that?
Yeah.
Oh, go on.
Yeah. Obviously, there's the anticipation. But I'm going to go for, he's with, I think he's with Brad. And Brad's like, you promise you won't tell that? And he goes, oh, my mother's. Up there. On my mother's grave.
With them.
I assume this is one of the song lyrics. Your apple pie don't taste too nice.
Yeah.
You're essential as a pencil, is your one.
Well, I don't like it. Eel first drink. And I'm going to go for, and crawling on the planet's face, some insects called the human race. Lost
there
in
you space, are.
Lost in
Look
space
at that.
And meaning. I know all of it.
Amazing.
Many, many times. Shall we score it?
Let's do it.
Yeah.
All right. Performances. Wyndham.
I've just upgraded them to an 8.
I've given it an 8. Laurie.
9.
Effects. 7 from me.
5 from me.
9.
Plot. 8 from me.
Eight.
6. 6.
Laurie, rewatch factor.
9.
10.
Ooh. 6.
Direction. Oh, Wyndham.
8.
7.
Cinematography, Laurie.
7.
5. Sound and music. 10.
7.
9.
Originality, Laurie.
9.
10.
Ah, no, screw it. 10, screw it.
Yeah. Wyndham.
10 for me as well.
Yay. Wyndham, enjoyability.
I gave it a 7.
Oh, 10 for me.
9.
And life-changing, past or present, Laurie.
I'm going 6.
Right. 10.
It gets a 0 from me. Huh. But had I watched it in 1975 with themes like transvesticism, bisexuality, sexual liberation, voyeurism, transsexualism, that would have got it a 10.
There we go. All right, so
it is a belter.
86.
83.
86 and 83.
It's yours? What was yours?
And I gave it 62. Gives it a round 77.
77. Right, well, that puts it even Stevens with Battle Royale. Third place. And then our overall thing, it's on the leaderboard. It's 8th.
Well done.
Very good.
Oh. It knocks off Psycho, I'm afraid, but there you go. You can't have everything.
That's all
right. Right. Okay. So is it my turn to choose? I think it is, isn't it?
I think it is, yeah.
Brilliant. Oh, fuck.
Go on,
then. Expecting the balls to appear from
there. Yeah. Give you some idea, listeners. He's locating his ball sack to pluck.
There we go. Ball.
Actually, wait a minute. Who's
got up?
You're plucking.
Yeah, I'm plucking.
He's plucking.
I'm choosing. I'm doing it all. And the number is number 7.
What's it going to be? What's it going to be? Wait a minute.
Number 7.
Hold on. Flip it out.
Wait a darn pick in second here.
Laurie's golden ticket.
Oh! Yeah. What the hell? How are the chances?
1 in 100.
That is amazing. Oh, guys, right. Okay, so. Oh, no. Lighthouse. Okay, so the first one.
Yeah.
Will be. I can't pronounce his name. I'm going to give it a go. Andrzej Zawiski's Possession, 1981, Sam Neill, and, oh, damn it.
Yeah.
Beautiful Lady, Isabella Anjani. So, Possession, okay, that's the first one.
Uh-huh.
The second one will be Bob Fosse's All That Jazz.
Hey.
With my absolute hero, Roy Schneider, playing Bob Fosse himself, basically. Great film. So there we go. That was definitely on the hoof, that those two, though. I could probably come up with better, but you're having them.
Great. Nice work. Well, it seems
I have seen neither of those films.
Seems like the universe is in balance again.
I think so. I love you guys desperately. We need to do this more often.
Yeah, well, I'm going to go and watch Requiem.
And in person.
No! Don't do it! Move on! Move on!
All right.
The reason I watched started watching The Matrix again last night, and that is a bloody good film.
The first film is great.
Yeah, the first one.
They're making another 3, aren't they?
So
what's
good.
What's the point of that?
Apparently.
All right, anyway, enough of this world of Matrix.
I'll see you tomorrow.
Lighthouse.
Ciao. Bye.